is a pleasure to introduce Ursula Huws, who is going to have a lecture titled Labor and Class in the Internet Age. This morning we had Giuliano Carchetti with a similar title, but the contents probably won't be similar, so looking forward to it. And the title, his title was Capitalism in the Age of Internet. And as I've said, Ursula's title is Labor and Class in the Internet Age. She will begin by summarizing the changes in employment patterns since the mid-20th century, since the middle of the 20th century, which she chopped up into four distinctive phases, and the fourth phase being dubbed as the Internet Age. So she will describe the changes in the employment patterns, sorry, in the international division of labor, commodification of activities which previously belonged to the public sector, and she will conclude by drawing out the implications of these developments for labor and class in the next epoch of global capitalism. Just to conclude, Ursula is professor of labor and globalization at the University of Hertfordshire, UK, and the editor of the international journal Work Organization, Labor and Globalization. So Ursula, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Can everybody hear me? Good, good, good. First of all, I'd just like to say what a great pleasure and privilege it is to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me, and especially to Anita for all the hard work that went on in organising this. I have to say this is, I've met some of you at previous occasions in Zagreb and in Belgrade, and every time I meet you, I'm enormously impressed by the high quality of the debate that happens in the former Yugoslavia, by the kind of comradely spirit in which these debates take place and how well informed they are. And I wish there were debates that take place in the rest of Europe were equally of an equal standard. So thank you so much for inviting me. Now, what I'm going to talk about today, I'm going to together some possibly slightly disparate things. And I've decided again, is that me? I'm going against my usual practice on these occasions. I decided I needed a PowerPoint. So I'm afraid I'm inflicting a PowerPoint on you. First of all, as Anita said, I want to talk about changes in relations between labour and capital since World War II, very, very quickly and briefly to set the scene. And what I'm, of course, talking about mainly is capitalism in the more developed heartlands of capitalism, so to speak. One can't talk about capitalism without talking about labour because capitalism is a relationship between labour and capital, and it's changes in that relationship that I want to quickly summarise. I then want to look at the dynamics of change with particular reference to the labour theory of value, but other things too, and draw attention to some misunderstandings about these dynamics. You know, we have, as Guillermo so eloquently argued this morning, you know, there are an awful lot of misconceptions around right now about whether classic Marxist concepts can be applied at all to this new conjuncture that we're in. And it seems to me necessary to try and bring a little bit of clarity to those discussions. And finally, if there's time, I'm sure Anita will shut me up if I go on too long, but I'd like to talk a little bit about the implications of this new situation that we found ourselves in for class composition, class consciousness, and class struggle. So, to start with, I think since World War I we can talk about, do a sort of crude periodization. Now, there are always huge dangers in any periodization, any historical periodization, because the seeds of whatever happens in one period are already sown in the preceding period. There are dangers in drawing attention only to ruptures, but there are dangers in drawing attention only to continuities. And I think it's useful to to see that there are certain historical moments, sometimes with a kind of a symbolic event that triggers a change in consciousness about them, that there are certain moments when tendencies reach a critical mass, and that critical mass transforms a quantitative change into a qualitative change, and a new set of norms are taken for granted norms. So to very quickly go through this period, period one is the period classically described as post-war Keynesianism, the post-war Keynesian welfare state, these lights are so bright it's really hard to see, the l'âge d'or, or the Fordism, or the trente glorieuses, or whatever. This post-war period after World War II, when in most of Western Europe and in the United States and Japan and the other heartlands of capitalism, a kind of a new, what you know, one might not want to call a regime, but a new set of norms came into being. It's important, I think, to remember that there was a Cold War context. The Cold War was the context in which these changes took place. And the Cold War gave labour a certain bargaining power in relation to capital that it hadn't had in preceding periods. Because there was this real fear that the working classes of the West would turn to communism, so to speak. So there was a kind of kind of propensity to strike deals with labour, which was probably historically not quite unprecedented. There are rather more specific deals one can point to in early historical periods, but it was on a new scale, let us say. And in this context, a normative model grew up of what employment should look like, that it should be full-time, it should be permanent, that society was organised around a male breadwinner and a female housewife, and that employment relations should in some way be regulated. Now, this, of course, this normative model never applied. There were lots of workers to whom it never applied. But nevertheless, it was set as a legitimate aspiration, not only in developed countries, but it was kind of set as a model for developing countries. This is what developments look like. This is what you should be aspiring towards. You know, if you look at Egypt or India or, you know, during the 1950s and 60s, you can see right across the world this idea that this was somehow a legitimate model to aim for, which I think was quite powerful, really. There was still, on the whole, capitalist organisations were still quite small. There was still a lot of national capital. There were, of course, multinational companies. On the whole, they were quite small. And there was a kind of idea that employment could be regulated through a tripartite model with capitalist organisations represented by employers' associations, workers represented by kind of reformist and bureaucratic trade unions, and national governments in this kind of tripartite model. I'm going the wrong way. And also, the technological state of development was such that workers actually had, in some industries, in some sectors, and in some companies, they had a lot of bargaining power based on the need for very specific skills that were tied to very specific technologies. And that buttressed by other things like the Cold War context. It gave labour a kind of bargaining power that it had rarely had, except in certain sectors, before or since, really. So, that's period one. Period one, symbolically, I guess, comes to an end with the oil crisis of 1973, but a lot of the tendencies were already there in formation. You have a crisis of profitability of companies, very clearly, declining rate of profit, which is visible, and leading to a sharpening of conflicts between employers and labour, a real push on extracting more surplus value from labour. This is accompanied by a drawing on a reserve army of labour, increasing use of migrant workers, Most obviously, you know, countries like Germany, with workers coming from Turkey and Greece, or in the UK from former colonies in France, or so, from North Africa, and so on. In Japan from Korea, in the United States from Mexico, etc. There was this growth in use of migrant workers. And an increasing labour market participation of part-time women workers, which had the effect of depressing the male wage in real terms. Because when you have, although there never was a proper family wage in the preceding period, in the preceding period for an elite group of skilled workers, it was possible for the male wage to provide subsistence for an entire household. If you can create a normative model where the subsistence of the household requires both a full-time male wage and a part-time female wage to keep it going, then effectively the rate of capital has managed to extract more labour power from the members of that household. So there's a very important gender dimension to what was going on in this period as well. You have during this period an increasing size and scope of multinational corporations, increasingly spreading beyond these national boundaries. And the development already of a new international division of labour in manufacturing industries during this period mainly, the clothing industry, the shoe industry, car industry, textiles, the beginnings of electronics, but that grew more in the later period, and so on. So already a disciplinary effect coming from this global reserve army being pushing down the bargaining power of skilled workers in the advanced capitalist countries. And this rather curious situation where national and regional governments, who are under political pressure to get re-elected to create jobs, to not have mass unemployment, or were forced into this strange competition to attract foreign direct investments, to try and attract a car factory or whatever it was, which signaled a shift, if you like, in the power of national governments to control international capital. So that is the start, shift in that relationship. During the 70s, especially, the development of the early stages in terms of their permeation across the economy, the development of information and communications technologies, which made it possible to simplify and standardize many labor processes, including service activities. And I don't think it's accident that the labor processes that were targeted very early on were those of the best organised workers. In my own personal case, I was a trade unionist in the printing industry at the time. You know, the print workers who were very well organised were very one of the first groups whose labour processes were transformed through information technology. So that's the period that really carries on up till the end of the 80s, but all these tendencies gathering force. And the next big symbolic moment, I guess, is the falling of the Berlin Wall. I think you can date the next period from around 1990 to 2006. There was, of course, the end of the Cold War, which opened up truly global markets, including labour markets, and removed from the fear that workers might become communist, which enabled employers to much more aggressively pursue the policies that had already been in formation and developed in the previous period. I mean, it was in the previous period that, you know, Thatcher destroyed the miners' unions in Britain and so on. You had the spread of ICTs reached a critical mass, and this was linked with, this isn't just a market, this isn't just technology developing the market, but a lot of very active neoliberal initiatives at an international level to, for instance, to deregulate and privatise telecommunications infrastructure, to also to to bring services and intellectual property within the scope of international trade agreements. In other words, to create as free a movement of as possible of information and intellectual property and capital around the world, but absolutely not labour. The free movement of labour was not part of the deal at all, which is a contradiction in the policy of this period. You have an enormous growth in standardisation, interoperability of systems, but just straightforward standardisation. Standardisation of qualifications, standardisation of various processes. If you look at ISO standards, the number increased absolutely exponentially. There are tens of thousands of ISO standards governing just about every industrial process you can think of, in just about every industry you can think of. And a huge growth of international standard qualifications, not just what has gone on through like the Bologna process and so on in Europe, but through the spread of standard Microsoft certification or SAP or Cisco systems or whatever. And this may seem like boring detail, but these are actually the preconditions for having an efficiently operating global division of labour. If you don't have standards, Lego bricks, you can't build up, you can't make things out of Lego. If you don't have standard containers, shipping containers, you can't shift the goods around the world seamlessly from ship to port to train to truck to etc. And it's the same with labour processes. So this standardisation is absolutely critical to understanding the global division of labour that emerged afterwards. During this period, we have to recognise this was a highly unstable financially and political period. We had the Asian financial crisis, the dot-com boom and bust, etc., etc. But out of all these developments, by the end of this period, there was a almost mature, nearly there, a global reserve army of information workers. Whose existence had been pushed by public policies. It hadn't just grown up in the market. The World Bank was pushing IT training in developing countries. The European Commission was pushing it. The standardisation, standard courses, making sure everybody speaks English, you know, what are the global languages, trying to push particular education systems onto developing countries and so on. Now, this global reserve army of labour, this grew, it didn't just grow up all by itself, it was pulled. This global reserve army, of course, can be accessed in two different ways by employers. You can move people to jobs and you can move jobs to people. So there's a sense in which migration and offshoring are two sides of the same coin, actually. And also, of course, includes ICT-enabled services of various sorts. And this existence of this international division of labour has an enormous disciplinary effect on labour in most developed capitalist countries. People often, like the American trade unions, absolutely obsessed about how many jobs are lost to offshoring, and they look at the quantitative impact of offshoring. That's really neither here nor there. If a company has 20 call centres and they put one in India, the impact on jobs is trivial. I mean, in terms of India, there's a sector growing, but in terms of jobs in the United States, it's absolutely trivial. But what isn't trivial is the fact that the workers in the 19 other call centres can be told, if they ask for a wage increase, right, your job could go to India next week. They know it could go. It's the disciplinary impact on labour, which is what's, in my view, has been absolutely critical about the development of offshore outsourcing. So, and in the process of all these developments, something that grew up really almost unnoticed till about 2004-2005 was a new kind of global company, which supplies outsourced business services, both to the private sector and to the public sector, right across the economy. And these companies grew in a very unnoticed way, partly because they grew through transfers of personnel. They didn't go out and recruit new workers. You know, let's say Fujitsu decides to outsource its IT to Siemens Business Services. You know, 300 workers might stop being Fujitsu employees and become Siemens Business Services employees. And these companies were then able to, the outsourcing process itself encourages further standardization, and further standardization then enables the companies to offer even more cheaply. So you've got a self-confirming process, if you like. And these companies, having established themselves in the global market, were then able to very aggressively offer their services to public sector organisations as well as private sector organisations. I've spoken about that at length elsewhere, so I won't talk about that today. So this standardisation of labour processes underpins a modularisation of tasks, if you like, which enables an elaboration of value chains. Things can be relocated spatially, or they can be outsourced, or both. But we're not talking here about inevitable trends of decentralization or centralization or go to Asia or not going to Asia or coming back from Asia or whatever. It offers employers more and more possibilities in terms of creatively developing new permutations and combinations. The more standard any given labor process is, the more those tasks can be reconfigured, endlessly reconfigured, both legally and spatially. And that was kind of the landscape that had formed itself around 2006. Oh, the other thing I probably should mention is that in the period between 2000 and 2006, there was a huge concentration of capital. There was the highest mergers and acquisitions reached an all-time historical peak in 2006. The share of multinational companies in global employment went up by about around 20% in a year. The market share of these companies also went up by around 20% in a year. On the face of it, these companies were expanding hugely. But during that same year, investment in new greenfield sites went down. So this was an accident waiting to happen, really. This was a huge concentration of capital, but it was big companies cannibalizing little companies. They were growing through acquisition, but not through new production. And again, I've written extensively about that, so I won't repeat that now. But anyway, well, what that means, this is the context in which the financial crisis, which again is the symbolic change moment, 2007-2008, the conjunction we're now in is, we've got this, as I just said, I thought I'd forgotten it from the previous slide. It's on the beginning of this one. This a huge dominance of multinational corporations, of which a significant proportion are now based in India and in China and in Brazil. And the huge accumulation that went on in the previous period produced surpluses, which then, of course, get reinvested back in the developing capital world. This is why in Europe's steel industry now belongs to Indian companies. Europe's brewing industry belongs mostly to the largest single company, is a Brazilian company. The iconic IBM PC, the company that made it, now belongs to a Chinese company, and so on. You know, so these multinational companies are not actually necessarily based in the traditional heartlands of capital. The spread of ICTs has become near universal, really. Even mobile phones in poor parts of Africa, for instance, have spread absolutely phenomenally. And the global division of labour has reached maturity, you could could say. It's now, you know, senior manager of companies are no longer asked to justify why they've decided to outsource, but asked why haven't we done it. Yeah. You have to have a good reason for not outsourcing. Employment precariousness, I don't want to overgeneralize about this, because it's clear that there are many, you know, these things take time to change, and there are many sectors where workers remain organized and still have decent working conditions and decent employment conditions more generally. But it's increasingly become the norm, especially for the young, that that this expectation of the permanent job for life that was established as a norm in the, let's say, the 1950s and 1960s has now more or less disappeared. Young people are not only are they're much, much more likely to enter the labour market as employees, if indeed they're employees at all, they might be on some more precarious contract than that, but as employees of large global corporations, they're much, much more likely to work for a large, even if they're cleaning the street or doing care work or working for McDonald's, the chances are that their employer is now a global corporation. And they are generally very aware that they are in direct competition with members of the Global Reserve Army, whether as migrant workers or as sort of virtual workers, you know, working for, whether, you know, you're working on the internet, whether from Mechanical Turk or Odesk or Elance or something like that, it's clearly very visible that you're competing with, you know, somebody in Kazakhstan or wherever it is. But equally, if you get a job in your local McDonald's or cleaning a hospital or something like that, then you're also very aware that you're competing directly with migrant workers. So this sense of being in a global labour market is very, very strong, it seems to be. And I would argue that we have entered in this period a new phase of capital accumulation based on new kinds of commodification. None of these things are new. These things were already happening in the previous period, but I would argue they've become critical mass now, and they've become, for the capitalist class as a whole, significant sources of profits. You know, that there are new industries that have now become important places for capitalists to put their money, so to speak. The first of these is public services. The scale of the commodification of public services is just huge. Even if you leave aside actual privatization, if you just looked at outsourced, for the provision of outsourced services to public sector organizations. In the UK, back in 2007, it represented 6% of GDP, which is a hell of a lot. That's bigger than the food and tobacco industry, for instance. It's really a big big chunk of money. And since then, of course, it's gone up an awful lot. The only country in which it's even higher is Sweden at that time, in the research I came across in 2007. No accident. the more decommodification you have, as S.B. Anderson would call it, the more scope there is for recommodification. So, you know, the countries with big public sectors offer richer pickings to the multinational companies that want to come and grab them. I guess you've seen quite a lot of that here. I know in Croatia they've seen a lot of this grab. So the commodification of public services is very big. We've also the commodification of what, for lack of a better term, I call biology, is now very big. Huge new industries based on basically gene therapies, DNA, genetic engineering of various sorts, lots of new biotechnological products. These are, you know, statistically that's become critical. And that's another, it's another kind of primitive accumulation, or in a way, in the same way that you can argue, not everybody would agree with me, but you could argue that the any sort of appropriation of the commons by capital to create exchange values out of what was previously use values, you can argue that that's a form of primitive accumulation, really. So biology, art and culture are increasingly become the basis of big new industries. This commodification of art and culture is I think, I won't go into it because we don't have much time. And the other field, and these are not, I'm sure I haven't encompassed it all. The other field that I think has increasingly been commodified, or at least the activities that were previously carried out outside the money economy for their social use values have become the basis of new industries is sociality, sociality itself. You know, you see four kids coming out of school and they're all on their mobile phones talking or texting. And they're not talking to each other, they're all walking down the road together, they're not talking to each other. You think, well, so what? Well, you know, O2 or whatever company is making money out of every second of that conversation, and all the companies that sell the apps to the Apple and the others, etc. So it's there's a new field of accumulation, let's say, grown up around sociality itself, which is actually it's quite something to get your head around, really. anyway, so this is the conjuncture we're in. This is the conjuncture we're in. And I'm now going to move to something completely different, which is how do we think about labour in this new context? And the reason that I'm emphasising this, and the reason I've created a diagram, is because, as we heard this morning from Guillermo Cacchiedi, that there's an awful lot of very confused thinking going on right now, that people, that the idea of the labour theory of value no longer applies, such as Marx's idea of class no longer applies, that even the idea of what is labour and what isn't labour, we need new models to understand these things, we need new models to understand how value is created. There's a lot of extremely confused thinking around, and it matters, it seems to me it matters, because the political conclusions that flow from this confused thinking can be quite obstructive. If you actually believe that everybody who uses the internet in any way is creating value while they do it, or form part of an undifferentiated multitude or precariat or whatever, that has implications about how you organise, what demands you make, and where you make them, how you make them. And it seems to me that in my argument, it seems to me there still is a point of production. It's harder to identify. There still is a point of production. And the point of production really matters, because it's at the point of production where labour meets capital. Labour is not the only place where people meet capital. You meet capital in the supermarket, in the cinema, and in the sports stadium, and wherever. But it's the workplace, or the point of production, I prefer to call it because it may not necessarily be a physical space, is where labour meets capital and has some agency. Because it's through that encounter that capitalism exists and can be perpetuated. And the struggle that takes place, the critical struggle that takes place at that point of production is, finally, it's the struggle over the workers' labour part time and how much of the value produced through that labour time is appropriated by the employer. And it's an old story, and it's a simple story, but there it is. And you can't take that story and understand it without thinking seriously, and I think this is where a lot of people go wrong, thinking about this, is that the workers' subsistence, the workers' need for subsistence is an absolutely critical part of that story. The worker enters the capitalist labour market with her or his labour power and knowledge, of course, of creativity, but that's all bundled up, in my opinion, that's all part of labour power. That is all the worker has to offer. And that is the worker's vulnerability in that market, but it's also the worker's strength, because that's what the employer needs. So if we can't keep our eye on that place where that exchange takes place, that antagonistic and sometimes violent exchange takes place, then we really can't understand the labour theory, we really can't understand capitalism, we can't understand anything, in my view. So, how do we think about labour in this new conjuncture? I use a model which Guillermo would disagree with some details of this. I think we need to talk separately about two different dimensions of labour. One is whether it's paid and whether it's unpaid. If it's paid, it's producing, contributing to subsistence directly. If it's unpaid, it isn't. And secondly, is it producing, is it only producing use values, or is it actually producing a profit for a capitalist enterprise? Is it producing surplus value? And so I conceptualize these on this 2x2 matrix. And I call, for the sake of peace, because you're all too young to remember it, but in the 1960s, this issue of productive and unproductive labour was a very, very contentious and difficult thing to talk about. And did housework produce surplus value or not? Parties split over less than that. It seems to me a useful way. What's wrong? Let's call it reproductive labour. It's producing use values, these use values can be carried out without the payment of money. You can be directly producing use values in the home. You can be caring for people. You can be cooking for them. You can go out in the wood and chop down a tree and build furniture, whatever, So you have the unpaid labour producing use values in that top right yellow corner, so to speak. And then you can also have paid labour producing only use values, either domestic servants, for instance, or public sector workers, or whatever. You then, across the bottom row, you have in the bottom left-hand corner, commodity production, which is actually producing commodities, whether there's commodities have taken material form or not, whether they're services or not, doesn't matter. They're commodities. I would include, some people would disagree about this, but I include distribution activities in commodity production. Marx was very, very ambivalent about this. He included transport. But he didn't include some other distribution activities. I'm sure if he'd been alive now, he would have included more. But anyway, and then in this bottom category, there's a category that I first came up with way back in the 1970s, this idea of consumption work, which is, when we sort of start thinking about online activities on the internet, I think it becomes more important rather than less important. Consumption work is unpaid work. You could say, well, why isn't it up with all the other unpaid work producing use values? And the reason I think it's useful to think about it separately is because it's labour which is externalised from the purple corner here. Employers can increase their rate of exploitation of productive workers by externalising certain tasks onto consumers, whether that's persuading them to come and fetch the goods from the factory and take them home, whether it's persuading them to assemble the flat pack furniture instead of having the worker build the IKEA chest of drawers. And it seems to me that it's fundamentally different. Assembling your flat pack shelves from IKEA is different from going out in the woods, cutting down a tree and making your own shelves, simply because you're helping IKEA make more money when you do the former, but not when you do the latter. And I think this is a useful category to think about. But I'm not claiming that it produces surplus value, right? And let's be clear about that. So this is my overall map of labour, which you can agree with or not. But what I want to do now is look at how the recent changes are brought about. There are the very dynamic shifts go on between these different kinds of labour. And I want to emphasize, I'm talking about different kinds of labour. I'm not talking necessarily about different workers, because the same worker can do more than one kind of labour. So you shouldn't. Well, I don't think one can simply read workers off from typologies of labour. And even more so, I don't think you can read typologies of class off from different typologies of worker. So to get from here to talking about class is quite a complex process. Anyway, let's just quickly look at some dynamics. Obviously, there was a huge shift in the, especially in the third quarter of the 20th century and the 50 years after that, the shift from unpaid labour to paid labour, producing use values in this huge growth of the public sector that took place. There are huge debates about whether or not public sector workers were part of the working class or not. I think that's quite a complicated question. It's certainly the case that when industries were nationalised in the 1950s and 60s, that public sector workers had a consciousness of themselves as members of the working class because they came from working class families. They had a working class attitude when they entered the labour force of not wanting to let the employer rip them off too much and so on. There are sort of cultural ways in which you could argue that they're part of the working class. I would argue with Guillermo that they weren't actually producing surplus value at that point. You also have women's entry into the workforce and, of course, more recently, increasing social polarisation has created a huge new demand for private services, for cleaners, for nannies, for increasingly that demand is met by migrant women, indigenous, white, educated women in Europe, Western Europe and the United States and Japan have been able to enter the workforce on more or less equal terms with men, on the basis that a lot of their reproduction tasks in their homes are done by migrant women from poorer regions. You also have a commodification of public services has created a massive shift. It's transformed a lot of that public sector employment into a kind of employment that is directly creating surplus value. So there's been a huge shift. Tens and hundreds of thousands of workers have been shifted, sometimes knowingly, sometimes not knowingly, out of the category of workers producing only use values into workers that are actually now producing exchange values and have now entered that direct conflictual relationship with capital. You think particularly of these huge global companies that are like Serco, like Accenture, like Capital, etc., which have taken over the provision of public services. In that process, you know, very large proportions of it. In some cases, in some countries, a majority, it shifted the majority from being public sector workers to private sector workers, like parts of Sweden, for instance. You can see this happening. So there's been this huge shift of workers there. Then you've also got, as the pressures on the household increase because of the lengthening working day, the increasing requirement for women to work in the labour market, you've got a shift from unpaid labour from traditional forms of unpaid labour to consumption work, buying things in the market rather than making them in the hole. And austerity, of course, has reversed a lot of, it's shifted a lot of activities back into the home. It's transformed paid public sector work producing use values into unpaid public sector work producing use values. So you've got, I don't want to go into great detail, you can map a lot of other changes onto this, but what I'm showing is that there is basically these huge shifts between different kinds of employment. And meanwhile, partly helped by the internet and other technologies that enable kind of new kinds of so-called self-service, you know, people buying their own airline tickets or, you know, whatever it is on the internet, internet shopping. There's also been a huge externalization of labor from this productive sector, you might say, and the creation of new kinds of unpaid consumption work. Now, this is, you know, so, I mean, we could go back to that diagram a moment and just say, you know, here we have a whole lot of trends that collectively add up to, probably at a global scale, more workers in this directly productive sector than ever before. A huge, but also an incredible intensification of the extraction of value from those workers through a whole variety of things, using the global reserve army to police them, externalizing as many activities as possible onto consumers in order to intensify the exploitation that takes place within that group, increasingly drawing on, often in the name of gender equality, you know, defining that the wage as the part-time woman's wage is almost the normal wage, almost bringing down very dramatically the overall household remuneration level. And so here we have this context where you could say the point of production has never been more important. You've never had more workers working for large global capitalist employers. You could almost say, well, workers of the world unite, this is the moment they actually could. You know, they're all working for the same companies all around the world. And yet you have theorists on the left and elsewhere that's talking as if there is no point of production anymore. This doesn't matter. So what's going on? I'm just going to talk a little bit about some, have I got time, all right for time? About some of the obfuscating factors. The first obviously obfuscating factor is the spatial and contractual diffusion of production through these very elaborated global value chains, the fragmentation of tasks, and the sense that workers have a very, often don't have at all a clear idea of how their job fits with the jobs of other workers. So, you know, what is their contribution to global value chains? They're working for these little subcontractors of subcontractors of subcontractors in a geographically isolated way. They might be doing the most extreme example of this, which is working for Mechanical Turk, you know, on these tasks that involve two keystrokes, and you get paid 5 cents, you know, for completing 10 tasks or something like that. So that is clearly makes it very hard for workers to get their heads around what it is they're producing, how it is that their labour is directly enriching the capitalist employer. Secondly, I think this is really important in terms of obscuring the connection between the wage and the labour. You've got neoliberal welfare regimes which give subsidies to low-wage employers through the tax benefit system. The tax credit is the sort of neoliberal preferred welfare regime option. The organisations like the McKinsey Global Institute went around in the 80s and 90s trying to advising Gordon Brown in the UK, the Indian government, Lula's regime in Brazil, all around the world, going around saying, you know, tax credits are the answer. Well, tax credits are a direct subsidy to low-paying employers. The employer can pay below subsistence on the basis that the worker's wage then gets topped up. And that doesn't just involve a subsidy. I mean, in the UK, just to give you an example of the scale of it, there is a huge ideological kind of assault on welfare claimants. You know, we're talking about the scroungers, you know, the welfare scrounger, the benefit scroungers. If you look at the statistics, less than 8% of the welfare spending in Britain goes to the unemployed. 27% goes to people who are low-paid workers, who are actually in jobs, but earning so little that their welfare benefits need. You can do the same analysis in the United States. So one study I saw said, you know, every worker in Walmart is subsidized through things like food stamps and Medicaid and something, to a phenomenal extent. It's something like 30% or more of the wage comes in the form of these subsidies. But this, it doesn't just confuse people and allow this kind of ludicrous idea that the hardworking person is somehow subsidizing these idle unemployed. It also gives workers no incentive to join a union. Because if you've got this means test based subsidy to the wage, the only reason, the main reason historically workers join unions is to get a wage increase. If you get a wage increase that just gets knocked off your benefit, what's the point? So it completely, you know, it deters workers organising in a whole lot of ways. What else? Intergenerational transfers are terribly important. And in general, household transfer. This is one of the things that Marx and Engels were actually very, very unclear about in the labour theory of value. They talk about subsistence, but they never say whose subsistence. Is it the worker's subsistence? Is it the immediate family? Is it the extended family? How does it work? And they were so locked into this idea of the male breadwinner idea that there's one point where Engels actually talks about women and children in the workforce. And he sees them as the property. He theorizes them as slaves. That, you know, the male worker is sending his wife and children out into the labor market and becomes is theorized as a slave owner, because so this idea of subsistence really needs to be unpacked in a whole lot of ways, and this is not the moment to do it, but this is a task for feminist theory as well as Marxist theory, I think, to do that. But intergenerational transfers are hugely important now. If you look in Europe, the number of kids in their 30s and 40s still living with their parents, for instance, because in order to subsidize jobs that are below subsistence level, or unpaid work, internships, and stuff like that. Next, we come to these very confused discourses about immaterial or free or virtual labour, which I say some of you are smiling, and you're obviously familiar with these discourses. So I won't, and we also heard a bit about them this morning. I won't go into them in great detail, other than to just show this is what people who argue that doing unpaid work on the internet is somehow producing surplus value are basically arguing more or less this, you know, that you know, you're doing you're working for your university and writing your articles and then making money for international journal publishers, or you're sitting at home writing Wikipedia entries or whatever it is, and you're producing, this free labour is producing surplus value. I mean, I'm not denying that capitalists take advantage of it in the same way they take advantage of the Earth's natural resources. You know, they will steal it if they can steal it, and they will pay a minimum price for it if they have to pay a minimum price for it. But that doesn't, it seems to me, mean that these workers are producing surplus value. And what one has to look at is quite simple, really. These people who are producing this free labour, is where does their subsistence come from? This is the question to ask. Either they're subsidised by other family members, or they're subsidised by an academic salary, or they're subsidised by a well-paid journalistic job, if that hasn't become a complete oxymoron by now. The subsistence must be coming from somewhere else, basically. If they're not, in my view, engaged in an antagonistic struggle with the employer about subsistence, about what share of the labour power comes back to the worker, then they're not involved in directly in capitalist labour relations. So that's let that be my last word on this. Now, have I got time? This is my last slide. I'll quite quickly go through this, because there are, of course, all these things have huge implications for how we think about class. One of the things that is a kind of ambivalent, but historically, the kind of building blocks of class identities have tended to be occupational identities. I mean, different countries have different sorts of trade union traditions and so on, but historically workers have organized around occupational identities. And this is ambivalent because it's an exclusive identity. It excludes as well as including, and we all know how we've also how women, for instance, have been excluded from certain occupational groups. Nevertheless, if you don't have some sort of stable occupational identity, some sort of idea of what job it is that that person does, you can't see with which other workers there should be solidarity, so to speak. You can't get from an individual identity to a collective identity. And if you can't do that, it's very, very difficult to develop, I suppose, what you could call class consciousness. And what just seems to have been happening, I think new occupational identities are emerging in various places, but there's been a dissolution of traditional occupational identities and job descriptions and collective identities, which I think is a big challenge, really. We have this issue which I've raised earlier about thinking about the individual versus the household as a unit of consumption, but it's not just about as a unit of consumption, it's also a unit of class identity. And you have when you have these very fractured kinds of labour market participation with several different household members engaging in the labour market in different ways, it becomes very difficult for common identities to emerge. This has always been a real blind spot, I would say, in Marxist theory, actually. I mean, I've written about it over the years quite a lot, is this sort of elision between people enter the workforce as an individual, but they consume as a household, and they often engage politically as a household. You know, if one member's on strike, the rest of the household supports them, and so on. But this, so to speak, splitting the atom of the nuclear family is a complicated thing to do. And I don't think we can start thinking about political identities without really paying a lot more attention to that. There are also other, I don't know why I phrased it that way, impediments to develop. I think what I probably mean is not so much impediments as, firstly, time lags. There are time lags between a public sector worker who cares passionately about the patients they look after or the kids they're educating. There is a sort of time lag between giving your all to the job because you're committed to the use values that you're producing and realizing that the private sector employer that's taking you over doesn't give a shit about the kids that you're looking after and only wants to make as much profit as possible. And this kind of shift in consciousness and awareness that has to take place takes time. And people are conflicted about it because people are very committed to the use values that they are producing, they want to produce them. And the same goes in a slightly different way for artistic and creative workers. You know, they've got something to say, they don't want to say it, they want the chance to say it. And the moment doesn't always come, it usually comes at some point, it doesn't always come, when you suddenly realise that, you know, all your intellectual property now belongs to the employer who's going to do something else with it and suck you. There's what I call the ka-ching moment, you know, the moment when the worker kind of hears the cash register going and realizes that they've been expropriated. You call it the moment of alienation or so on, which took place among industrial workers several generations back. But it's a new process for public sector workers and for creative and artistic workers and so on. And I think that their reality is quite contradictory. So I think, you know, we need to think quite a little bit about that. I've written about that elsewhere, but I won't bore you with it. The other thing that is very important looking at the global division of labour are the racial, the ethnic divisions incredible, I mean, if you talk to call center workers in India, for instance, they're exposed to the most incredible racist abuse at the firm. And the response to that isn't to sort of feel this deep solidarity with the American workers who are abusing them. It's to, very often, not always, it's to kind of identify with your national bourgeoisie and to say, well, I'm doing this horrible job in a call centre and taking all this abuse because I want to help develop India. And I want my kids to do better than me, and I want my kids to be well educated and go to school so they can get a job where they don't have to listen to racist abuse at the phone, and this is development and so on. So you've got all these very complicated things going on, and racism is clearly a very, very important part of that. And not just in relation to offshore, but also in relation to migrant workers. So I'll finish really by saying the point of production is very hard to find. You have to do a lot of very boring empirical work very often. If you're looking at internet companies, let's say, finding out what their business model is, what they make money on, which labour processes produce what, where in the logistics value chain, you know, the critical workers, the land value, whatever. It's a lot of boring work, but it seems to me it needs to be done because, in my opinion, the point of production remains the crucially important place where this encounter between labour and capital has to be understood and acted on. And there's just a few references in case anybody's interested.
Thank you, Ursula, for this comprehensive and clarifying lecture. And now we are entering into the questions and comments time. Yeah. So feel free to raise your hand.
Thanks. Enjoyed your talk. Your last point, you said that we need to investigate in detail point of production. And you also clearly said that what some theories call free labor, and I'm as critical as you are of their development of that kind of labor, you said they don't produce surplus value. But let's say an academic employee produce free software. However, let's say that some product based in the free software is directly sold as a commodity, and it requires exchange value, and there is surplus value there. However, a lot of workers involved directly in that production, but not managed by capital directly, the firm that produces that produces the commodity out of it. They're paid by universities, are laboring on this, they're working, whatever you call it, on this product, which then company sells. So obviously they don't produce use value because it doesn't end up being used as use value. It ends up as an exchange value because it ends up commodified, packaged and sold later. However, they do work, they labor, and they're paid. So they do, like you said earlier, like they don't struggle for the return of you know, the wealth from total social wealth. They do, they get it from university. However, that labor gets used. In that sense, it's free to come, but not free at the point of it's still a wage from a wage labor. What do those workers produce? What do you reckon? What's your take?
Well, first of all, I should sort of correct you on one thing. Use value and exchange value isn't an either or. A use value, things that have exchange values also have use values. So everything has a use value. Well, everything that's produced has some kind of a use value. I would argue that sometimes it's kind of quite a negative. But it's having the exchange value as well as a use value, not instead of, if you see what I mean. I would say, yes, capital expropriates. It always has expropriated, and it will continue to expropriate. And you know, those academic workers are producing, I would argue, use values, which may acquire an exchange value after they have been expropriated by the capitalist and incorporated into other products using the labour, as Guillermo said this morning, using the labour of their direct employees to transform them into new products. But, you know, but basically those academic workers are not directly producing surplus value for the capitalist employment. I would go on and make another statement by syndicalist past showing here. From the point of view of the labour, which is not a substitute, you're not paid for by the university, they are more or less scabbed. They are undermining, they're directly through their, every time an academic writes a book for nothing, they are, well, depending on the topic of the book, but if an academic writes a popular book about a popular topic for nothing, they are directly undermining the bargaining power of an unemployed writer to make a living out of being a writer, because they are devaluing that labour. It's, you know, if I decide to make T-shirts from love and give them out to people on the street, I'm undermining the position of the workers who need to make a living making T-shirts. And it seems to me that's what's going on in relation to some sort of labour solidarities. There are some really quite difficult things going on when you look at free labour.
Small comment, the thin line there, the Marx and Engels collected works, have just been, there is just a legal case that they're being threatened, the publisher threatened the Marxist author to remove them from the internet, saying our existence is threatened. Because we are not selling books, so therefore, but it's a very thin line to walk. Is it a single publisher that's more vulnerable to society, or collected works of Marx and Engels being available free at the point of use?
By
volunteer labor, for example.
I'd like to come back on that, because this petition is doing the rounds at the moment. I have to say I signed it. Not because I don't believe that writers should have copyright in their work, which I do. I'm a member of the National Union of Journalists, and our members rely on having copyright in their work. But Marx and Engels are long dead. that copyright should have expired by now. That's my argument. It should be. It's now a public good. For Lawrence and Wishart to deprive us of that public good seems to me absolutely appalling.
I have a couple of questions. I really enjoyed the talk, and I agree with a lot of the conclusions. But I have two questions about the sort of theoretical underpinnings. The first is about something you mentioned. You said that periodization is very difficult, and I agree. Periodization of history is very difficult, and that's something I agree with. It was very noticeable that when you looked at different periods, you had a whole list of different items, which are often quite different kinds of items, turns in the economic situation, ideological shifts, shifts in imperialism, shifts in Fordism, and so on. I wondered really theoretically, what is it that synchronizes those different phenomena? What is it that forges them into a single period and justifies this periodization? Because it can seem very arbitrary, the division of time into periods sometimes. Secondly, a very specific question. I don't really understand, I don't think, the category of consumption work. You refer to it as unpaid work, but also directly productive labour for capitalist enterprises. But then you say that it's not productive of surplus value. So I'm curious about what sense is it productive then? And there are two examples that you gave. One was flat-pack furniture. But it seems to me that by removing that bit of the labour process, what they're doing is cheapening the furniture by saying you can assemble it at home, they're producing a much cheaper and different use value. You can still buy assembled furniture, or you can choose not to. The other example you gave was going and collecting something from a business directly. But again, the trend sometimes goes in the opposite direction in this case. You think about Tesco's, one of their big growing areas of business is delivering groceries directly to your door. Think about Amazon. What they're doing is removing some of the consumption work for you to go and browse books, and they'll send it, you click on a button, they send it directly to you. So maybe I've misunderstood that category, but I wonder if you can explain what exactly you mean by that.
Okay. context of, there was a very interesting article in Monthly Review by Amy Bridges and Batchel Weinbaum called The Other Side of the Paycheck, where they used the term, and I thought it was very interesting and thought about it a little bit more. There was also a you're probably all too young to remember Lord Buckley. There was a jazz musician called Lord Buckley who wrote a wonderful, it was kind of song, a proto-rap, you might say, called Supermarket. He says, every time you're pushing that trolley up on the hands, you're loading that trolley up on the stuff, and you're working for them. You're working for them. That sort of really crystallized for me the early supermarkets, the way they successfully trained consumers to do all those tasks that had previously been done by paid workers. But the immediate thing that triggered me was the campaign by bank workers about the introduction of ATMs. They were just introducing ATMs for the first time when I wrote that article. And it was clear that the banks were going to massively increase their productivity by persuading customers. You used to have to stand in a line, you know, to get cash out of the bank. And the employers had a very conscious strategy to encourage people to use the ATMs, which involved artificially creating scarcity. That where they were going to put an ATM outside the bank, they would reduce the number of tells so that the queues would be really long. And then they would have encourage workers they would have people, like they do on the automated check-in in airports. In the early stages, they have these people hovering around in uniforms, showing you how to use the machine. Because it creates so much extra profitability for the company to encourage people, obviously, to take on what used to be paid tasks. And they're prepared to invest an awful lot in the transition. And of course, 10 years down the line, you know, the only way you get cash is from some terrible urine-smelling machine. Possible mugger around the corner about to hit you. And the same with the automated, you have to queue for the automated checking machine as well. So there's a systematic, there's lots of management literature that shows how companies make huge money out of externalizing tasks onto users. And it's now becoming on the internet that I'm charging a premium for even talking to a person in the call center. You get it cheaper if you do all the labour. It's not just the physical labour of taking the order. You do all the data entry. If you do something online, if you do your online shopping, you're doing their inventory for them. Because all the data entry is being done by the consumer as well as of course as generating the data that they're able to target with more. So consumption work is very clearly growing. Historically, the first person to try it, Jane O'Shimmy wrote a book way back in the 70s called Towards the Self-Service Economy, where he actually he measured, you know, how much, what chunk of the economy was taken up with, like, persuading people to use laundromats instead of laundromats and so on. You know, the economists have calculated it. It's considerable. But it just seems to me theoretically that it's useful to separate it out from the other kinds of studies that are generating. I'm Catholic about it. Don't have strong views about it. I just find it conceptually useful myself to see it as a different category of work, especially if you're trying to understand what's happening online. Online activities. If you do this like a time diary of the time somebody spends online, you can such and such, you can actually allocate different tasks to different categories. Some of them might be genuinely producing surplus value, it might be like your job. Some of it is consumption work. Some of it is what Guillermo so brilliantly called being a mental agent as opposed to a mental laborer. But it seems to me it's very useful if we want to understand the political economy of the internet, to actually allocate labour to these categories. Periodization, I mean, how do you measure critical mass? You can measure it as sort of the share of the economy of a particular sector. You can measure it in a lot of different ways. I don't want to go there. All historians have to categorize it somehow or other.
Okay, anyone else? Yeah.
Your diagram with four sections. Again, if you can get back, it's So. The first section, A, paid labor, you said there it's productive for society and capitalism in general. But let's say if 80% or 90% of all outputs are produced that way, then obviously it's hard to talk about capitalism because you would be able to say, to sign up the first sentence of capital to say that the society is where, you know, the wealth is, shows itself as commodities, because it will show itself as elements allocated according to needs. So let us imagine that happening for a moment. And commodities really go down, they're suppressed in dark corners, so you're going to see commodities. All you get is just output of stuff, whatever you need. What is it productive for you? What would that be productive of? I mean, do you have any conceptual, how would you conceptualize that kind of production? Do you have any ideas on it? Because obviously it plays a large part in what you discussed. And even your characterization of the welfare state after the Second World War clearly was an expansion. And today, EU 15 is 35% gets allocated of 35% of GDP is outputs allocated according to needs. Not talking about police, it's an additional factor.
I've got hearing aids and both ears, and the acoustics are so good. Could you repeat that?
So, obviously, this categorization of yours, you have a category which is important for your understanding of economics. But it's unclear, these public goods, I mean, would you simply call them public goods or, you know, how they stand in relation to, it seems too simplistic to call them use values because they are paid with ones. Their inputs are monetized as well. And, you know, the entire chain is paid for. It's just that they are allocated according to needs at the end. And there is an exchange, but it's planned. Because you plan for labor, you plan for rent, you plan for machinery. So, you know, there is a whole production process. It's just the end bit. It's planned in advance that it will be mass produced. So I'm just wondering whether you have any thoughts on that.
I should first say that the way it's written there is actually not totally accurate. What I probably should have put is productive for society as a whole from which capitalism incidentally benefits, because it's not like for capitalism. But the point I wanted to make is that capitalism benefits and requires certain things like public infrastructure, like an educated workforce, like eradication of disease. Like, you know, capitalism in order to function requires some kind of public underpinning, some kind of commons that they benefit from in a direct way, or an indirect. So it indicates that really. And when I say reproductive, I include reproducing the workforce and reproducing the environment. Those kind of things as well in that general phrase. This question about, the more general question about commodification, I think it's terribly difficult to see. I mean, S.P. Anderson's concept of decommodification, I've always had problems with it, really. It's like, you know, once something is, it's like Humpty Dumpty, you know, once it's broken, if you try and reassemble it, it's not going to take the same form as it had before it was commodified, if you see what I mean. And I don't know enough about, I mean, I guess you will hear no much more. About a society in which ostensibly not capitalist, you know, and what character the commodities have in such a society, what values people have. But I know that having done case studies for commodification of public services, I know that once the logic has been introduced, once a capitalist kind of organizational logic has been introduced in an organization, where you start giving people performance indicators and, you know, counting their output and market testing and seeing how would it compare. Here we have this public service. Let's just say what it would look like if we bought in a private company. As soon as that logic has been introduced, it starts driving a different way of managing things and a different relationship with labor. And I think it's terribly difficult to reverse it. I mean, maybe it can be done. I don't know. I'd like to think it can be done. But I think you need such a huge change in consciousness in the workforce. Because it's very, that kind of thinking is very contaminating. It gets internalized. Not just by managers, it gets internalized right all the way through the workforce, I think.
I'd like to comment on what Tony said. You seem to imply that if something is monetized, then this poses a problem for us conceptualizing it as either a use value or a value. But I mean, stuff has been monetized long before capitalism emerged, and value exists only in capitalism. So I don't know what the problem seems to be with the whole public sector debate. If something is planned, if something is outside of market competition, and if something is produced according to needs, as you say, then regardless of whether it's monetized or not, it is not a commodity in Marx's sense, in the capitalist sense. It can be exchanged. I mean, I remember a quote from the third volume of Capital where Marx says that something can be an exchange value without it being a value. I mean, land in feudalism was exchange value, but it didn't have any value, because obviously feudalism isn't capitalism, and value exists only in capitalism. So I don't think this is a problem. If 90% of all production in capitalism was organized in this public sector way, obviously we don't have capitalism.
Then you kind of, we don't have capitalism, yes, but we have something that Marx has not lived to see. Yes. So he could not have theorized castles in the sand, and yet we seem to shark those castles in the sand that we live through today, the public sector, the socialist sector. We want to forcefully shark them into the Marxist ass so that we get some kind of empirical view of empirical reality as we have it. So, you know, Marx simply hasn't experienced that war. He had no experience, therefore he could not get it. And we would have socialism, fine. But my question is then, how would we call those outputs? And, you know, how would we build them theoretically on the same level of instruction like Marx, as following his great insights at work, but not being slave to his inability to see future? Because I think, you know, we have to give man credit who would want to see future. Because he was at least brave to say, let's not predict what the future brings. But we live in that future that we didn't see. We've seen public sector. Well, but you know, we've seen 35%, we've seen in socialism perhaps 78% of being held by capitalist production, or I don't know, 80-something% of individuals' life. So how would you call that, if it's not a commodity, if it's not, what is it? And how do we cure it? If, you know, we don't have MCM without capitalism, it just doesn't happen, it's not good. If you use money to produce public goods, it's not capital. How do you, what do you call it?
Okay, well, we shouldn't discuss this here, so later.
It's very interesting, actually.
I agree with you, yes. Marx didn't experience this, and to your question, I think we should call them use values, and such a production, planned production, public sector production is basically theoretically the same as production in feudalism on some different level. In feudalism, you had planned production on the basis of tradition or arrangement or so on. in socialism or in this hypothetical society you speak of, you would have production according to, I don't know, democratic deliberation or dictatorial plan, like in Stalin's country and so on. So I agree, he didn't experience that, but it doesn't matter, because his theoretical framework is suitable for this.
Grieving continued, but as English would say.
Well, I guess in imagining such a society, imagining such an economy, which I think we all need to try to do from time to time, is it seems to me that the real difficulty is imagining human needs. We talk very quickly about providing according to needs, but needs themselves are socially structured. Expectations are socially structured, and they change historically. You know, and once the electric guitar is there, you know, the playing of the folk music has a different kind of a character. And there is enormous technological change that has been, and there will continue to be. And a lot of apparently utopian ideas that are around at the moment just simply involve, so it's like let's freeze, let's all just live with the technology that we've got, and kind of rearrange the division of labour. And they all, like Andre Gorz, for instance, or Ivan Illich, who were writing in the 80s and 90s about such, let's everybody work 6 hours a week and don't have necessary labour time, and all the rest of the time we can compose symphonies. The problem with that is that the labour which is not yet in paid labour, the changing the baby's nappies and scrubbing the floor, is completely invisible in these utopias. It's like, you know, who minds the baby while Village is writing his symphony or whatever, when Adam blocks, who's cleaning the floor? And so I think we have a real problem about that. The current idea that's going on, this is our idea that 3D printing is going to produce a new sharing economy. Well, as somebody who's brought up young children, I can imagine nothing more of a nightmare than having a new kind of home-based production, having this bloody machine in your kitchen with these extremely hazardous plastics and things, which nobody works out how they've been transported there or by whom, under what conditions. Introducing a completely hazardous new household industry with no economies of scale, with no division of labour. It just seems to me like a recipe for a particular kind of hell, actually. I mean, that's the sharing economy. Count me out, you know. But no, I think we do really seriously need debates about not just making lists, you know, like a Sen style, or much a Sen style lists of what basic needs are, but more about what kind of social processes could make needs visible, and also make the unpaid labour visibly there as part of what has to be shared. I think this is really challenging.